Iran is promising swift retaliation after a key scientist in its nuclear program was killed in an alleged assassination plot. Iran's defense ministry confirming he died Friday when his car was attacked outside Tehran. Top Iranian officials are pointing the finger at Israel. The U.S. says it is closely monitoring the developments. And the aircraft carrier, the Nimitz, is being sent to the Persian Gulf, though the Pentagon says it's unrelated to escalating tensions with Iran. CNN's senior national security correspondent Alex Marquardt joining me now. Hi there, Alex. Have we heard anything from Israel about this assassination?
Hi there, Amra. No, we haven't, and I don't expect we will. This is not the kind of thing that they generally comment on. They have not denied responsibility. They have not claimed responsibility. Essentially, this is a win-win for them because everyone thinks that they were behind this attack, this assassination of Mohsen Fakhrizadeh, and he is now dead. We have not heard anything from the U.S. government either, not from the White House or the Defense Department. You did note that that U.S. official said that they are watching the situation closely, but what we are hearing from Tehran is that there will be revenge for Fakhrizadeh's killing and that it will come at the right time, according to the president, Hassan Rouhani. This is someone who was not just a leader in Iran's nuclear program. This was very much the architect, the father of Iran's military nuclear program when it began. And then he continued to be a senior leader at the helm of Iran's nuclear program after that covert military program ended in the early 2000s. Fakhrizadeh was someone who was named by Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in a presentation he made about Iran's nuclear program in 2018. So the message here to Iran is clear. We can find your top nuclear scientist and we can kill him in broad daylight. This was a brazen attack, one that was carried out surgically with a lot of precision, in the words of a top U.S. intelligence official, former intelligence official I spoke with. And now you have a situation in which in the same year, two very senior figures were killed. The head of the Al-Quds force, Qassem Soleimani, by a U.S. strike in January, and now Fakhrizadeh getting killed just 10 months later. And so the question becomes, how does Iran respond? They will certainly feel pressure to respond. This is hugely embarrassing for them. But at the same time, they know that that Joe Biden is coming in and wants to re-engage with them, wants to go back into the Iranian nuclear deal, and wants to alleviate the sanctions. So it's a very tough position for Iran and certainly very complicating for incoming President Joe Biden.
Yeah, very difficult situation indeed for both sides. Appreciate you, Alex Marquardt in Washington. All right, let's talk more now about the escalating situation with Iran. Aaron David Miller spent more than two decades in the State Department, advised both Republican and Democratic presidents, and was a Middle East peace negotiator. He joins me now. Thanks for joining us. And let's answer that question. You know, what does Iran do now? Iran is blaming Israel, as we said, for this. The U.S. is taking this wait-and-see approach at the moment. And former CIA Director John Brennan tweeted and called this move reckless and warned that it could provoke lethal retaliation. He also called on Iran to, look, resist the urge for retaliation. Will Iran do that?
I mean, you know, Amr, this is an asymmetrical response. The Iranians have any number of options. We've reduced our troop deployments in Afghanistan. That's certainly a possible arena. So is Iraq, where the Iranians have demonstrated a capacity acting through pro-Iranian Shia militias to respond. I mean, you might even get, and this would be a very difficult scenario, a pro-Iranian militia responding on its own. I think the red line here, frankly, is the deaths of Americans. If in fact the Iranians choose to respond before January 20th, I think they seriously risk the prospects that a Trump administration, as its final act, in an effort to bind the Obama administration, and to support the president's maximum pressure campaign against Iran, you could conceivably see, I'm not predicting it, I think the odds are low, depending on what, how the Iranians respond, but you could see an American unilateral strike against an Iranian nuclear facility if the Iranian response involves the deaths of Americans.
Is the timing of this significant at all, especially the fact that it's happening during a time of transition and, you know, President-elect Biden is set to take office in less than 2 months from now?
Yeah, I think timing here is extremely important. I mean, there, as Alex pointed out, there's been a pattern of attacks. In January, Qasem Soleimani was killed by the United States. In July, there was a mysterious explosion at the Natanz nuclear enrichment facility in Iran. And in August, the second in command of Al-Qaeda was killed through Israeli proxies at the apparently at the request of the United States. So there's a pattern of activity here. But I think for the Netanyahu government, for the prime minister, there is this sense that the Trump administration provides a sort of zone of immunity. And I think the Israelis have taken advantage of that fact to strike now. Whether or not this constrains or restrains the Biden administration with respect to its own efforts to engage the Iranians, I think will depend very much on what happens in the next several months. But what's happened here is going to make that a hell of a lot harder.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that, you know, you have any diplomatic efforts that Joe Biden would undertake with Iran being undermined before he even takes office, I mean, that really does complicate any attempt for Joe Biden to re-engage Iran and possibly negotiate or renegotiate a nuclear deal.
I mean, it certainly does. I mean, it's a heavy lift to begin with. Simply re-engaging in the Iranian nuclear deal is probably not an option. If the Republicans maintain control of the Senate in January, that'll provide an additional constraint. And there's no doubt in my mind that this so-called non-meeting that Prime Minister Netanyahu had with Mohammed bin Salman of Saudi Arabia a week or so ago was an effort in part to create a common front on the part of the Israelis and the Saudis and send an explicit message to the new administration, understand what our interests are here, and we're not interested in your returning to anything like a normalized relationship, or at least a diplomatic process with Iran.
Aaron David Miller, appreciate your insight. Thank you very much.